The digital delight of jazz and what's more on WFDU HD2, TNEC.
Revoice and sing till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won.
What's going on? What's going on? What's happening? You are now bluesing with Jack Dapper Blues on WFDU HD2. Yes, it is that time of the week. Your weekly dose of blues music, history, heritage, traditions, and culture. Today, for a featured part of the show, 5 to 6, our featured guest, agent, manager, producer, photographer, promoter. If I'm not mistaken, this was Sun House's manager. Sunhouse, Eddie James Sunhouse is who inspired me to pick up a national and go for broke. Would you all please give a warm welcome to Dick Waterman? How are you, sir?
Hi, how are you?
I'm well. You have a long tenure in blues. So, you know, it's an honor to have you on the show, and we get to talk about a lot of things. And you've done a lot of things. So I guess, to be fair to the audience, those who don't know you, but I'm sure most of my listeners do know who you are. Let's start with the day you fell in love with the blues. Can you remember that?
I started out in the early 60s as a big fan of Louis Armstrong and Dixieland and that kind of music. Then I kind of drifted into the folk scene of Cambridge in the early middle 60s. And then somebody had said that they had seen Sun House coming out of a Memphis movie theater, 1964. Mm. Two other fellas and I went down looking for him in June of 64. And it was a very long search. We went from Memphis, and then we finally backtracked him up to Rochester, New York. And we found him there in June of 64. So up until that time, I had been a sports writer. I'm a very, very happy sports writer. I like doing it, and I would have done that for the rest of my life.
Mm.
Had found Sun House. We had to find work for him. So Nick Pearls was going back to college, and Phil Spiro was a computer programmer. So it kind of was up to me to find work for this newly rediscovered bluesman. And I want to admit that of the three of us, I knew the least about country blues. So I found work for him, 64, 5, 6. And then Bob Kester of Del Mar Records said, there's a whole generation of younger blues men that you should look into. So my first one was Junior Wells.
Wow.
Just released a new album called Hoodoo Man.
That's right.
Album. And so I added Junior in 66. The next year, Buddy Guy. The next year, Luther Allison. And that's kind of how it went. In 1968, I met a student at Radcliffe by the name of Bonnie Raitt.
Wow.
He wanted a career in music. He was only 18 at the time. So she became my opening act for people like Fred McDowell or Big Boy Crudup. And And so I gradually started to work more and more with her. She got a recording contract in 71, and then her career sort of grew. And then I moved to Oxford, Mississippi in 1986. And at that point, I turned back to my photography. I had been always shooting with the blues men in the early, mid-60s. And the interesting thing is that I have found now over the years that the photographs of mine that are the most sought after are my young Bob Dylan. I started to photograph Dylan about 62, and I went on tour with the Rolling Stones, and my Rolling Stones negatives are really good. So my stuff from 50 years ago of Dylan and the Rolling Stones is in demand now.
Wow. Imagine that. You know, you mentioned something that was really interesting to me. So you were a sports writer, and it just so happens you and these two guys stumbled upon some information. Now, first of all, who are the two guys, and how, what made it important for you as a sports writer, not knowing the least about country blues amongst the three, to take part in this journey to hunt down pretty much, to me, the king of the blues?
Well, I had heard of Muddy Waters. I had seen Muddy Waters in a jazz club in Boston, and I had heard of Howlin' Wolf and John Lee Hooker, but I wasn't really familiar with them as people or musicians. And then you have to realize that Son House was a full generation before them.
Right, absolutely.
And like, Muddy came on in like the 40s and 50s, and Son House recorded in 1930. So I was really a whole generation ahead of B.B. King and Bobby Bland and those people. So I had to get up to speed pretty quick and sell these guys.
Wow. So now, before we go into the rest of that journey, there's a documentary or some sort of movie that depicts you and the gentleman looking for Son House, while there's another couple of gentlemen looking for Skip James, correct?
Right. Now, there's a movie coming out, and it's really important. I want to hit you to it. It's called Two Trains Running.
Right.
Documentary made on the three guys who left California to find Skip, and the three guys who left the Boston-Cambridge area to find Son. We each came into the northwest corner of Mississippi, around Tunica. We were looking for Skip, and we, Nick Pearls and Phil Spire and I, were looking for Son House. Now, here's the amazing thing. Back in 1930-31, each man had made an odd number of sides. I think one did 7 and the other did 11. Their odd sides were put back to back on the same Paramount record, never been found. Now, when we found Son and they found Skip, it was Sunday, June 21, 1964. Mm. The date is notable because the three civil rights workers, Schwerner, Goodman, and Cheney, were murdered on that same day.
Right.
And the movie Two Trains Running deals with that. The amazing coincidence that the three civil rights workers were killed on the day that Son House and Skip James were both rediscovered. The movie, Two Trains Running, is playing the festival circuit now. But if you get a chance to see it, I really recommend it. It's a terrific piece of filmmaking.
Wow, absolutely. Absolutely. There's a lot going on right there. Wow, especially coming from the era that Son came from. So now, hold on. Before we even get back into that, you were just in another documentary that aired. I know a week or two ago it premiered, and then it aired on PBS, if I'm not mistaken, or PBS Online, about Fred McDowell.
Right, yes, yeah. I think it's called Shake 'Em On Down.
Right, that's exactly what it's called.
Right, I had the honor of managing Fred, and Fred was just a terrific guy. Whether he was playing music or not, he was just the kind of guy you wanted to meet, and he was a major influence on the lead player, Ackerman, Auerbach, rather, I'm sorry, for the Black Keys, and of course for Bonnie Raitt. Bonnie recorded one of his songs. And there's an album coming out shortly, which is a live album, and which Fred says, this is a song of mine that the Rolling Stones are going to record. And it really brings you back into the moment, and then Fred does You Got to Move. Stones did cover.
And that was one of my favorite songs about him. Now, you are placed dead smack in the middle of two things that somewhat repackaged the blues and resold it to America. That is the blues and folk revival and the British invasion. So are we talking that your timing was just correct? Did you guys, or did you, for that matter, know this all was happening at this time? Or was it just the timing was right?
Well, I think it's probably both, because the first time I saw Eric Clapton, he was with Cream. He had just left John Mayall's band. And those guys just knew Skip, and they knew Sun and all the old guys, Big Bill Brunsey and Garfield Akers, but they knew them off of American LPs, which were compilations of individual songs that they had made. There was a label called Origin Jazz Library, which came out with some great LPs of men who were assumed to be dead. Did John Hurt take his Son House or Skip James or whatever, Booker White, and they're all dead. But within a year or two of 62, 3, 4, at least five or six of these guys were found to be alive and brought back performing.
Wow. Wow. This is history. Wow. Okay, well, I hear that. I hear that. So now, you say that prior to rediscovering the Sun and then getting into the business of promoting and managing, you saw Howlin' Wolf and Muddy Waters and cats like this. When did you first hear the blues? When was it that you fell in love with it early on? And this was just a moment, or was it, I don't want to say an opportunity, but at the same time, it was an opportunity to help this aging bluesman as well as get involved in the music.
It was really folk blues. When you consider the meaning of the word folk in 62, 3, 4, folk was the umbrella that music played under. You could get a Memphis jug band or Appalachian style, or you could get the Delta or Gospel or the jug band people. It was all called folk. You could get Canadian fiddlers and things like that. Or the new songwriters coming in out of New York, Dylan and Paxton and Van Ronk and those guys. But it was all considered under the word folk. It really wasn't until 7, 8 years later that bluegrass and blues and others started to have their own festivals and draw their own audiences.
So, you know what? I had a conversation with a blues musician off the air, and we were talking about that folk scene of the village, right? Of Greenwich Village. And
in other words, my guys used to play the Gaslight for Clarence Hood, a wonderful old man on the Gaslight. And I had Fred McDowell play there, and Sun played there, and Skips played there. And in other in other words, in those years, the record company had guys out there. For, here's an example. If you were playing the Newport Folk Festival, 15, 17 minutes to play, then about four songs. As you went to the stairs going down into the backstage area, you're going to see John Hammond from Columbia, Maynard Solomon from Vanguard, Jack Holtzman from Elektra, Chris Stackridge from Ahuli. They would all be in the backstage area. And if one of them liked you, they would just go up to the blues man and say, listen, I thought you did a great set. Why don't you give me a call on Monday and give the blues man or his representative a card? And that was right there. There was not none of that. My lawyer will call your lawyer and we'll do lunch. Nothing.
There was no I'll do. So in other words, it wasn't Hollywood at that time.
Right.
So, okay, so that's good. That's a good segue. It was a handshake and business. How was it at this time? Because now, folk, this scene could be considered a specialty division, right?
Yeah.
Because it wasn't necessarily commercial at this time, but it was like a cult audience.
Well, in other words, as I said, Dylan was considered folk, and folk included blues, whatever, that some of the blues men had fans. Brownie and Sonny were there. Mississippi John Hurt was the best known of the rediscovered blues men. But they basically played a circuit of coffee houses. Small places to play, places 100, 200. The Cafe Lena in Saratoga Springs was growing then and is still growing now.
Wow, that's interesting. Let me ask you, do you think that country blues fell under the folk umbrella because electric blues was so prominent at the time?
Well, there was a time lag there that it was country blues. In other words, I want to let you know, Brownie and Sonny were on the scene. Jesse Fuller from San Francisco was on the scene. Reverend Gary Davis was there. So the first major electric blues to come into white music at that point was the Paul Butterfield Band. And the importance of the Butterfield Band was this. They looked like you. They were blue jeans and flannel shirts, blue harmonica, whatever. They were doing the songs of Elmore James. They were doing the song of Big Boy Crudup and people like that. Yonder's Wall and all the songs that had been done by Elmore James and Big Boy Crudup. And finally, it was that, now Muddy had been out on the circuit playing the jazz clubs. So when the folk world found Muddy, he had already been out there for maybe 5 years. There's an album of Muddy at Newport, 1960, that is great. It's always great. And it just shows that Muddy was out doing it before the older blues men were rediscovered and before some of the younger bands came out on the road, which was Buddy Guy and Junior Wells and Eddie King and Albert King and BB, of course, had been out there playing black music halls, whatever, from the 50s.
So now you said something really interesting. You said white music, and then you said these artists like Butterfield and the like looked like them. So you mean the audience on the circuit of folk was a white audience that the older black musicians was playing in front of, and then it kind of switched over when they were able to see a musician they identified with.
Right. Now, on the other hand, if white musicians wanted to play in St. Louis or Chicago or in Oakland, San Francisco, Oakland, everybody now looks back on it and they say, wow, these guys had a lot of nerve to go up and want to play with the great bluesmen, whatever. And it wasn't anything like that. It was, if you can play, you can stay.
So now, that's interesting. Talk to me about the terrain of this era, right? Because now, you mentioned early on that the day you guys found Sun and then the other guys found Skip was the same day of the Mississippi murders of the activists. So we're talking about a time that was still segregated. So how was the terrain? What was the atmosphere like when you're taking these old school black musicians from the Delta and the Bayou into these coffee houses?
We just felt that, you know, nobody was going to hassle us because we weren't looking to integrate the schools or anything like that. We were looking for blues men, that's all. In other words, we're a whole side issue to you guys. And we had some scary moments. In other words, guys in pickup trucks and rifles, you know, were out in the fields, and they'd see us and say, "What you doing down here?" They'd say, "Well, we came down here to record the blues." And they would look at us and they would say, "You three guys come from New York City in a yellow Volkswagen Bug just for the blues?" And we looked at them and we say, "Yes, sir." And they would say, "Well, you damn well reckon you can have it, because there ain't a porch around here that ain't got some black man out there picking on a guitar."
Wow.
"Take the blues, you're welcome to it." So that was it. We just felt we had a protection that, but in the long run, someone was just looking out for us, whatever. We never had any really scary situations.
Wow. Oh, wow. Well, what about traveling with the older blues musicians, the Sunhouses, the Fred McDowells of the world that you managed, and you traveled? Did you travel with the musicians to some of these places for them to perform and record?
Well, there were some that had to have somebody with them. Like, Sun couldn't travel alone. But some, like Robert Pete Williams from Louisiana and Fred McDowell and Skip, they were totally self-sufficient. That I sent them a letter with where the gig is and what the money will be. And with some of them, I made an airline reservation for them. And they would just go to the airport. And trust me that if they got on such and such a flight, that they would be met at the airport by somebody that I had arranged to be there. Now, something like that takes a real leap of faith. You got to have real confidence that what Mr. Waterman said was going to be true.
And, right.
Yeah. In other words, it was a whole different world back then.
Right. It was a phone call, and then, oh, well, I just got to go and see what happens. So now you say they were self-sufficient, but Sun had to have someone travel with him. Why was that?
Well, he had a serious drinking problem.
Mm.
He needed liquor to drink. In other words, he had a hand tremor that he couldn't play when he was sober, but he couldn't play if he was too drunk. So he had to find just some amount that was the right amount. I travel with small airline bottles of bourbon. I had a half gallon in the back, and I would refill the small bottles. So then he would have bourbon and then get ready to play. And then he could play and play well. But it was years later that when the news came out, you know, Sunhouse had a whole career while being an alcoholic. And I could just shrug and say, "Well, whatever gets you going, whatever you need."
Right. Wow. Did he ever share with you what got him to that point?
Well, he had lived a very, very hard life. In other words, coming up in the Delta, and he had traveled as a young man, and he had gone up to Grafton, Wisconsin to record with Charlie Patton and Willie Brown. That was in 1930, so he knew what it was like to travel for money. But then after the Depression came in about 1931-32, the race records folded. So they weren't recording any more Mississippi bluesmen after that time. So he wasn't recorded from 1930 until Lomax came in around 1941. So we lost over a decade of Sunhouse music.
Wow. And here's a question that I was speaking to another young bluesman about. Are there any Sunhouse recordings that we haven't heard? Every now and then, a new one or one that is not so often played sneaks up. But is there any recordings that we have not heard that's sitting somewhere?
I think it varies from bluesman to bluesman. I'll tell you a story. I was out in Los Angeles, spring of 65, with Sun, and we were staying in somebody's beach house with a fireplace. And I was just sitting there reading and writing a letter, and Sun was playing on the guitar, just playing and fooling around. And finally he stopped playing and he said, "There, I just did it." So I looked up and I said, "What did you just do?" He said, "I just played Clarksdale Moan."
Mm.
Wow, that was a song he had recorded in 1930, but never played after that. So I said, "You just played Clarksdale Moan?" And he said, "I sure did." And I said, "Wow, that was fabulous. I mean, we got to play that tonight at the gig." And he said, "What's that?" And I said, "Clarksdale Moan." He said, "Oh, I don't remember that. I used to play that years ago." "You just played it." He said, "Played what?" I said, "Clarksdale Moon. You just played it." He said, "No, I couldn't have done that. I did that 30 years ago. I don't recall that song." So we had that conversation in the air about he opened his world and played the song and closed his world and never played it again.
Wow. So was he a jokester?
He was quiet. He had an okay sense of humor or whatever, but he was really quiet. Some of the blues men were gregarious and outgoing. Booker White, Brownie McGee, they were very outgoing. Skip James regarded himself as an intellectual and felt that the average blues person talking to him like a fan was an intellectual, in other words, that he, Skip, was intellectually above them.
Really? So let's stay there for a minute. First of all, for those of you just tuning in, this is Jack Dapper Blues Radio on WFDU HD2, and I'm talking with a legendary Dick Waterman, photographer, promoter, producer, manager of a lot of the blues legends that you all share pictures of and attempt to play their music. Some of your attempts are excellent, don't get me wrong. Now, Skip James was an intellect, wasn't he? He finished what level of schooling?
Well, he thought that he was intellectually superior to all of the other blues men, and he treated them with disdain.
Mm.
He felt that his music was much more cerebral, and the others were just doing general folk songs that had been around forever.
Wow. So now I'm a little stunned considering where they all come from and considering what they endured. Now, I know at the turn of the century and Reconstruction, there were a group of African-Americans that felt a certain way. I never coined or pinned Skip James to be one of them. Was he close with Sun and Mississippi John?
he liked John as a person. I mean, how could you not like John? John is so lovable. But in music terms, he felt that he was on a whole other level.
Ah, okay. Now I'm clear. In his mind, what I gather, correct me if I'm wrong, but he presented his music as if he was the Mozart of the blues.
Right. Okay. Here's the important thing. None of these old blues men sat around and listened to the others. They just didn't. If you got to be 60, 70 years old playing your own music, you didn't get that way by listening to lots of other people.
Mm.
He was sitting by the stage in the 60s and somebody else would play. They would sit there politely, but they weren't there to be amused or to learn anything. In other words, they had their own music, they had their own style, and each of them, in their own way, would pass on that message. I play my own music. I don't take nothing from nobody else. I play my own kind of music.
That's groovy. That's really old school. Now, here it is. You are like I want to say a time machine almost, because you're right here dead smack in the middle of one generation, the older generation and a newer generation, right? So now with that being said, you have these guys who are like what you just explained. Now you have these up-and-comers who are extremely excited and zealous about being around these older musicians and learning, so quote-unquote, the tricks of the trade. How was that?
Okay, there was really only one young African-American musician who was on the scene in the 60s, who's still around, and that's Taj Mahal.
Mm.
Taj.
I hear. And so that's right, Taj Mahal was on the scene at that time.
He was. He was maybe 22, 23 years old, and he looked after them. In other words, he made sure that the right money was paid, that they had a place to stay, that they had transportation home. He was only a struggling musician himself. But the older black men, they looked at Taj as someone who would protect them. And Taj at that point being just huge and muscular. And when he came, as he said it, to make sure the folks are being taken care of. And he and I talk, and it's still about the folks. Those were the older black blues men. And, there were some others, Jerry Ricks from Philadelphia. Yeah, but Taj was probably the only musician who by the 70s was out there making a professional career out of it.
Wow. And still doing it.
Yeah.
Wow. That's...
Taj Mahal and Keb Moe just made an album together, and apparently they're going to be touring together all summer.
That's humongous.
Yeah.
You know, that's humongous. And that says a lot for the blues. So now, at this time, let's get back to this, because I'm sure you witnessed when the blues festivals and the selling of the blues albums started shifting from the Fred McDowell's and Son Houses to the Butterfield and cats like this. What happened during that stage?
Which one? You mean the white people or the black people?
What I mean, when it stopped being blues festivals or blues albums sold from black blues musicians, and it became predominantly or dominated by white musicians, the festival scene.
Well, in other words, the festival scene was rewarding for those who hung around. In other words, I used to say in the 60s, there were so many old black bluesmen, so many talented guys, and they're not getting their fair shot at the big money. So I said then, back in the late 60s, I said, there will be a time when there will be fewer bluesmen and the money will be huge. Because nowadays, you take a few $1,000 and break it up among 8 or 10 bluesmen, and they're not making money. But you've got to the point of late in the 20th century when you had Robert Lockwood, you had Pine Top Perkins, you had Honey Boy Edwards, you had Henry Townsend, and people like that. And the money got big, because where there used to be a couple $100 or something, by the time you got to 2006 and 7 and 8, these guys would go out and make $1,000 an airfare, $2,000 an airfare. That money could not even be conceived of back in the 1960s.
Mm.
It died off. The survivors could make a really good living at it.
Wow. Wow. You know, that takes a lot of perseverance to go 60 years into making the amount of money that I guess one would feel the music or time is worth.
Right, but by the time we got to 2000 and so, the older black bluesmen had white managers. In other words, that, you know, somebody who would not necessarily be a manager to take care of everything, but would take care of all the bookings, and you have a tour coinciding with a new album coming out. And, you know, there really has to, you have to find work other than warm weather festivals. So I always try to get my guys into the studio December, January, release an album in March, and then come out and tour in the springtime and summer.
That's a good plan. Are you still managing to this day?
Well, it's sort of a long story. I sort of retired, and I meant to stay retired. I heard a guy named Jimmy Duck Holmes.
Mm.
Holmes with an H-O-L-M-E-S. His nickname is Duck, Jimmy Holmes. He's from Bentonia and owns a club there, the Blue Front Club.
Mm-hmm. Blue Front Cafe, that's right.
It's one of the oldest jukes in the Delta. Now, there's a Bentonia sound made famous by Skip James, and then there was a guy named Henry Stuckey and another man named Jack Owens who lived into the 1990s. But they were contemporaries of Skip, and they passed this music down to Jimmy Duck Holmes. He plays stuff like Cherry Ball or Illinois Blues, all those Skip James songs, and he plays them in that same tuning, and it's just freaky. Him play, and you turn your back, and it's like 56 years ago, and it's like Skip. And he has those tunings and those progressions down, and it's absolutely haunting. So I said, I'm going to come out of retirement for him. So he has a new album out, and he's playing the an example, the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival, or Memphis in May, where he's being seen by 20, 30,000 people.
Mm.
Just totally boggling compared to the guys in the 60s who played for coffee house audiences or, you know, small situations like that.
That is. Could you imagine that? Wow. And, I mean, you know, Jimmy is the essence of the blues. So I would say that would be a good matchup considering your tenure in blues management.
Right.
So now you're seen at a lot of these festivals and workshops and things. You with a lot of the memorabilia of these folk. How does it feel when people run up to you and talk to you about all these guys that are legends in blues.
Right, but the thing is, the guys who are out playing now, the older black musicians, you know, I like really Robert Lockwood. He's a really nice man. I like Robert and Pine Top and all those guys. But you know, you really have to say is, when you hear the pure, undiluted first generations, when you sit on stage next to Sun House, or when you look over the piano top to Skip James playing, that's such a thrill and such a rush that the mind cannot help but make comparisons up to 2015, 16, 17. And when somebody comes up and says, wow, isn't he great? Let me blow you away. And you have to be polite. You say, yeah, he's really good. What you really mean is, he's good for what I can see now. But in my recollection, I saw the greats. I saw the masters. In other words, to see Muddy Waters work a big crowd like a master, what a real thrill that was.
Wow. That says a lot. So, now, you and I both know no one will ever be able to walk in any of these men and women, because I'm a big Memphis Minnie fan amongst other, but no one could walk in their shoes. That was their shoes, and they wore it well. But are you saying that you cannot see someone in this day and age that has the baton, that is of the lineage, playing that kind of music? Obviously not growing up, you know, on a plantation or a sharecropper, other than, you know, Jimmy and people of his age. Do you think that you'll be moved by one of these young cats?
I was at the Portland Waterfront Blues Festival on 2005, and they introduced a guy named Gary Clark Jr., who I had just barely heard of. I'd never seen him. And he came out, a really tall guy, 6'3", 6'4", skinny. And he played the old music just like he was fitting himself into loose skin.
Wow.
It out. It was like he stepped into a Robert Johnson song and made it his. And he played a Elmore James song and made it his. And I looked at that and I said, wow. In other words, he has the real capabilities to just take this thing and go. And I haven't really followed him very much in the past few years. But when I first saw him, the impact was there, because he was doing the older material, but he was updating it to his own style. In other words, I always tell people, musicians will play to the technology of their time.
Mm.
If amplifiers have been invented and electric guitars are invented or cordless pickups are invented, you play with the technology of their time. I used to manage Room Full of Blues, and they absolutely loved recording with one microphone. And I said, you know, there's eight or nine of you guys. You all should have isolated microphones. I said, remember this. Count Basie didn't record with one microphone because he wanted to. It's because he had to. That was the technology of his time.
True. True. You're 1,000% true. I mean, for that matter, we could look at a Sun House in comparison to Muddy Water. So absolutely. So now, and it's funny, because even we to this day that did not have the privilege or honor to see a lot of these guys when they were still fiery, you know, in that early 60s, still compares musicians of today to them back then. Do you think that has something to do with the industry of music and what is being pushed on the masses?
I just think that the industry was going to follow sales. In other words, if Blind Lemon Jefferson did a song called Please See That My Grave Is Kept Clean, then everybody went looking for a blind Lemon Jefferson. Nobody was trying to break through new frontiers in music. They just wanted to sell what was selling for everybody else. Now, you mentioned Memphis Slim. I gotta tell you, I shook hands with Memphis Slim, and my hand up to the wrist just disappeared into his hand.
Wow.
Huge. Had a big, firm handshake and a gigantic paw.
Wow. So he was easily in the bracket of Howlin' Wolf and Willie Dixon.
Yeah, I think so. He was a huge star in Europe. In other words, he traveled all around and was, you know, that for those American musicians who went to Europe and played there, especially champion Jack Dupree, Memphis Slim, whatever, they found that the European audiences were wonderful, hospitable, and they were able to work there. You know, to be able to work from the south of France up into Sweden and Norway, that's a pretty big territory. And, you know, you could come into England and play the pubs for a whole couple of weeks and make money.
Wow. So now, are blues musicians of today able to have that same sort of audio, or maybe even more, or do tours around Europe and the Americas as such?
Well, nowadays, wherever you go, you have to have a passport. You have to have a visa, and you got to be able to have work papers, whatever. In other words, if a country felt that their own musicians were not working enough, then they had the right to bar musicians from other countries who might be coming in and eating up the work.
Wow. You've given us so much history. Yes, I mean, it's been a long journey. You know, let's talk about Bonnie Raitt for a moment before we begin to wrap up, because from what I've gathered and heard, Bonnie Raitt was treated by her counterparts almost similar to how I see her face, but I can't think of her name. That's horrible. She was a great folk singer. Why cannot I think of her name? Anyway, she wasn't treated so great by her counterparts, and then here comes these older blues musicians that were just like, hey, come on, and grandfathered her in. Joni Mitchell. So it sounds like her and Joni Mitchell had similar crosses to bear, where their counterparts didn't particularly, their male counterparts didn't particularly give them the respect that they actually earned and deserved. But here comes these older blues musicians that were willing and open to allow her to come and jam with them. Am I in the ballpark there?
Yeah, you know, that I'm gonna make this point. All young blues people, blues man, blues woman, or folk, or hillbilly, or whatever, they all say at the beginning, if I make it, I'm going to look out for my mentors and the people that I learned from. I'm going to pay back. I am going to do it. But then they start to make some progress, and they start to develop, you know, a road manager, a couple of friends, then an album or two later, the traveling entourage is bigger, and it doesn't seem to be the right time to go back and start playing with the older people or bring them on as an opening act. In other words, it was a good thought by good people, but it becomes too hard to do. Your life becomes very complicated. But with Bonnie, she has maintained that she's going to do that. But after she became a real popular headliner, she found work for Fred McDowell, Arthur Big Boy Crudup, Robert Pete Williams, Robert Shaw, a Texas piano player, Roosevelt Sykes.
Wow.
She would put them on shows, and I was her manager agent, and I negotiated the deals. And I always said, we're going to give the opener a minimum of $500. And they would say, ah, that's crazy, that's crazy. He plays for $100 a night here. So I said, that's okay, it's not your money, it's her money. We're going to divide the money as we see fit. And if we want to give this guy $500, then that's it. And then Sippy Wallace came into Bonnie's life, and Sippy had recorded before, and Bonnie covered three or four of her songs. So the point here is that even after she attracted headline status, that we would have opening acts like Charles Brown or Ruth Brown, whatever, and up into the big amphitheaters with tens of thousands of dollars, and she took good care of them, whatever. And when I see Bonnie, we always talk about, you know, it's Fred's family, Fred McDowell's family, getting his royalty, and Robert Pete Williams' family getting his royalty, whatever. She always maintains that. In other words, she hasn't lost that. She made that promise, and she's kept it.
That's beautiful. You know, from the outside, it looks as if she's done so. You know, and you don't meet many, as you went into that statement, stating you don't meet many like that because of whatever reason. It's not always malicious. It's just things change. People change. She hasn't. That's great. I just want to take a moment to thank you for spending this time on my show discussing the history that you took part in.
Well, it's like they say, nobody gets drafted into the Blues. It's a volunteer army. And you're in it. I've been in it over 50 years now. And I've just made some wonderful friends. Just to sit there with Mississippi John Hurt, or to go to Africa with Junior Wells, I've been very, very pleased. I've been very honored with my time. And if I can pay back by doing your show, I'm happy to do it.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. We're honored. And, if we get a chance again to talk, I definitely want you to discuss that trip to Africa with Junior Wells, because to my understanding, that was a wild dude.
Right.
Well, again, thank you for your time. We're coming to an end of this segment, but again, thank you. You all have been listening to Dick Waterman. I hope you had your notepads out, because a lot of you are blues historian and enthusiasts, and some of you are, you like the blues, but you think you know about it. You got a first-hand piece of it right here from someone who was there with the folks, you know. And in honor of our conversation, I think I'm going to end this segment with some Sun House. So, you be well, sir, and I look forward to speaking to you soon.
I hope so. Talk to you later.
Talk to you later. That was Dick Waterman, everyone. Give that man a round of applause. You know that the archive will be up shortly, but until then, we're going to go into some Sun House.
She lived in you. You know that pretty little thing, she kept me with the Governor Fleet Blues. You know, on every day. She'd be standing round the landing crying. On every payday, she'd be standing round the landing crying. But hurry and bring home that man of mine. You know, on every payday she could have the big boat when she blows. She can yell the big boat when she blows. But when I done got the check, she told me she couldn't use me no more. But I say that's all right, little girl. That's all right for you. Yeah, whoo, little girl, that's all right for you. I say you treat me low down and dirty. Baby, that's the way you do. I packed up all my clothes, left her sitting in the back door crying. In the back door crying. You know that don't run the poor girl crazy. I believe she gonna lose her mind. You know, don't come here, honey, throwing up your doggone hand. I said, throwing up your doggone hand. You know I've been your dog ever since then. I've been your man. But I said, baby, when you get lonesome, sit right down and write to me. Yeah, yeah. Sit right down, you can write to me. You know I can read your little writing, baby. Don't care where in this whole world I be. You know love at all for make you do things you don't want to do. You know love at all for make you do things you don't want to do. You know, but love sometime will leave you feeling so sad and blue.